teaching sinks deep into our minds, Lord, that we absorb. Lord, I just ask that you will be with Jeremiah and bless him for just being able to share this knowledge with us. God, we thank you. We love you. Praise you, Jesus. Amen.
All right. We're going to be, we're in phase two, lesson three tonight. I want to welcome some of the new guests. Hopefully you guys can kind of jump in to where we're going. And each week we have a lesson. Some weeks the teaching will be longer. Other weeks we'll do more prophetic exercises, different things. But basically we are just dedicated to learning about prophecy, learning how to hear the Lord. Always try to reiterate that it's not about coming to class and hearing about prophecy for a couple hours, but it's about learning how to really spend time with God, learning how to hear His heart. That's something that's so important. I went down to Fort Myers on Friday to a prophetic meeting, a church down there, and had a really good time. Taught on the prophetic for maybe an hour and a half, probably had maybe 15 or 20 prophetic words for people in the crowd. Then I did some, basically let everybody go, closed the meeting down, and just asked if people wanted to stay after, that they could. So I thought that most people would go home, and we were there for about 2.5 hours. There were literally people that stood in line for 2.5 hours to receive prophetic ministry. They're just really, really hungry down there. So it's just interesting. Most people won't sit in a church service for 2 hours, let alone receive prophetic ministry. So there's a real hunger there. If you're interested in going with me, I'm going to be going back down on Friday again. If you have an interest in going, let me know. We can work something out. I think it would be really good for a lot of us here to get experience actually going to a meeting where the purpose is a prophetic type meeting rather than a church service, and maybe someone will speak up at meetings that are actually about hearing God's voice and you actually see it done. I think that it would stir a lot of your faith. I've been down there before. We prayed for a lady that had been in a wheelchair for many years, and she got up and walked right out of the meeting. And there's just a lot of really powerful stuff that goes on. There's a lot of really spiritual hunger, and that's at Fort Myers Christian Outreach Center. So talk to me after class if you have an interest in that. It's just not about learning about the prophetic. You want to really get involved in it. There's hundreds of people that you can all unleash on. You can pray and prophesy and see what God has. So if you're at all interested in that practically, please let me know. All right, tonight we are going to be discussing something that's dear to my heart. I want to go ahead and hand out these sheets, and we will get going. If you will, you're going to need to turn to 1 Thessalonians 5:19. 1 Thessalonians 5:19. It is on your sheet there. You're taking notes. 1 Thessalonians 5:19. Matt, read your translation, 1 Thessalonians 5:19 through 21.
Do not stifle the Holy Spirit. Do not scoff at prophecies, but test everything that is said. Hold on to what is good. Stay away from every kind of evil.
Okay. Do not what?
Stifle.
Do not stifle the Spirit. Do not
scoff at prophecies.
Scoff at prophecy. Okay. Do not stifle the Holy Spirit. Do not scoff at prophecy. Who else has another translation? Okay, read yours, man.
Do not quench the Spirit. Do not despise prophecies. Test all things. Hold fast what is good. Abstain from every form of evil.
Okay, so we've got do not quench, do not stifle the Spirit, do not despise prophetic utterance, do not scoff at prophetic utterance. Who else? Anybody have any other translation? Okay.
Just do not put out the Spirit's fire. Do not treat prophecy with contempt. Test everything. Hold on to the good. Okay. Avoid every kind of evil.
So don't quench the Spirit, don't stifle the Spirit, don't put out the Spirit's fire. Anybody else? Any other translation? So if it's telling us not to, what is it really saying? It is possible to.
Quench and stifle.
Okay, if it's telling us not to, it's saying it's possible to.
The Amplified says, do not subdue the Holy Spirit.
That might be my favorite. Do not subdue the Holy Spirit. You get in a lot of these meetings and people just kind of do whatever that they want, and if God is going to move, he's just going to have to come in there with a hammer. Writing here and saying, do not quench it. Do not despise prophetic utterance. Don't scoff at it. What does that mean to us?
Don't be a skeptic.
Okay, don't be a skeptic. Who else?
If somebody receives a really good word and you felt like it was for you, don't go, well, I don't like Paul because that was for me.
Okay.
Arnold.
Okay. Let's use our brains. What does that mean? Give me some nouns, adjectives, anything.
Don't mock it.
Okay, don't mock it.
I've heard so many that weren't accurate that you can become kind of throw out the baby with the bathwater.
Okay. Good. Look at verse 21. It says, but examine everything carefully. Hold fast to that which is good. That word hold fast, it can mean to possess or detain. But examine everything, which means when people prophesy, we're to examine it, to possess it, to detain it, to hold fast to that which is good. So to break this down a little bit more, it's saying don't quench the Spirit, don't put out the Spirit's fire, don't treat prophecy with contempt, but examine everything. So we have a responsibility as believers, as prophetic people, to examine prophetic words. Okay? It's saying don't despise them, don't ignore them, don't be skeptical of them, but examine them. And I think a lot of us, what we're going to find out is most people choose one or the other. We're either so cynical, so skeptical, heard there, been there, seen that, don't want to hear any more prophecies, or people that all they want to hear is prophecy. So 1 Corinthians 14:29, it says, let two or three prophets speak and let the others pass judgment. This statement here, it says, we cannot be too careful when scrutinizing prophecy. That's something that I really want us to keep in mind. So there are two types of thinking in the church regarding prophecy. Number one, rejects prophecy altogether. This thinking says we don't need prophecy because we have the Bible. They replace prophecy with teaching, preaching, and Bible study, the only three ways they believe God communicates. If you came from this type of background, raise your hand. Okay. I typically find, it's funny, I find a lot of people at the prophetic company that grew up with the No Way Jose. We don't need prophecy because we have the Bible. They replace prophecy with teaching, preaching, and Bible study. Most people have a common misconception as well that the preacher is the prophet. Preachers can have words from the Lord, but we want to be sure to make a distinction that there is also the ministry of the prophet, a different ministry than the ministry of the pastor or the shepherd. What do I want to say about this? I love God's Word. We have God's Word as our foundation. Prophecy should never, somebody speaking from God should never govern Scripture. That's a big mistake that we can make. If someone claims to have a word from God that directly contradicts Scripture, we want to throw that out immediately. So there's this one type of thinking. We're totally opposed to prophecy. And then secondly, we accept prophecy without testing or weighing it. Anybody from that type of background? Okay. This thinking says, any venture at accountability, any request for explanation, or any attempt at assessing the prophetic word is seen as an insult. This thinking says any venture at accountability, any request for an explanation, or any attempt at assessing the prophetic word is seen as an insult. People who aspire to be in prophetic ministry must become an established part of a local church. People who aspire to be in prophetic ministry must become an established part of a local church. For me personally, some of the most strongly prophetic gifted people either somehow don't fit in at a local body or don't feel the need to attend one. Below that it says a seagull prophet. People who fly in, make loud noise, spew on everyone, and fly out again. I don't know if you've ever been around these type of people who feel like it's their God-given right to visit random churches, just scream and make crazy noises, and prophesy doom or gloom against the leadership, or they don't like something. And this is what, in my opinion, has given the prophetic ministry a really bad rap. There have been numerous times when people without relationship have walked into places and just totally ruined it for a lot of other people. The answer, and this is the key really what I want to go after tonight, the answer to the misuse of prophecy is not no use, but proper use. The answer to the misuse of prophecy is not no use, but proper use. We should not insist that the gift be thrown away, but insist that it be used properly. So we don't want to be in the camp that says we don't need prophecy, and we don't want to be in the camp that says this is a free-for-all. We want to be in the camp here that says we want to learn how to move in the prophetic gifting with order, which is a rarity. I call it the radical middle. It's super, super rare to find people that flow in the prophetic that understand this radical middle. And teaching the Samuel Company for years now, this is something that is so, so important. Okay, look down there. How should we approach prophecy? It is vital that we as New Testament prophetic believers develop a culture of honor and accountability among one another, especially the church that we attend. Personal prophecy. A lot of tonight is going to be a lot of personal application. It's going to be a lot of advice. Personal prophecy. When prophesying over an individual, always make sure that there's a tape recorder available or a third party to write the words down. When prophesying over an individual, always make sure there's a tape recorder available or a third party to write the word down. So we're talking about accountability. We're talking about, we're not going to believe that there's no prophecies not for today, and we're not going to believe that I can just prophesy to whomever and whenever, and no one's going to come up to me and say, hey, brother, that's not right. Hey, you got some issues with your character, those type of things. So we want to create an environment when we personally prophesy over people that has accountability somewhat linked to it. It's very practical. A lot of times if I saw Matt out in the parking lot and I went up and gave Matt a word, Matt's probably going to retain about 10% of what I said. Unless the iPhone has become really, really handy. Nate's prophecies last week, we just handed around an iPhone, people spoke it to him. I burned it on my computer and gave it right to him. I know a lot of times people are like, I don't have a tape recorder. Well, most prophetic people carry around tape recorders if they're that used to prophesying. I used to do it all the time. But it's just a form of, this is what they said. Have you ever met somebody, had a conversation, they misconstrued your words. Happens all the time. A lot of times you want to have a record. And as we go in the prophetic, I have all the prophecies that have been spoken over me in prophetic meetings. I have them since I was 12 years old. 12 years old, I have prophecies that have been spoken over me. When I go to meetings, I always ask for copies of the prophetic words. I believe in listening to the prophetic words that are spoken over your life. Or having a third party write down the words, okay? This is something I know it's, doesn't seem practical. You're in a conversation with someone, things of that nature. I also strongly caution men prophesying over women in public places or women prophesying over men. You really have to be careful here. Since I personally have been married, I really will not, even if the Lord speaks to me about a girl at a grocery store or wherever, I really will not go up to her by myself. I will always ask my wife to accompany me. There's really something in covering and having somebody else as an eyewitness to what is being said. And I really want to encourage this class is about growing and maturing in the prophetic. And it is a great source of accountability. We don't want to just prophesy till the cows come home and no one is checking the words that we're saying. And it's not even so much that we're checking for accuracy, it's we're checking for content. We're checking for the heart behind it. There's so many different things that go into that. Okay, does anybody have any questions about personal prophetic ministry? Really want to encourage you to. I hardly lay hands on people that I don't know. Again, this is just, a lot of this is going to be me tonight. When you see me go down on Friday, I really don't lay hands on anybody, especially a woman. I'll set time, just ask them just to give me their hands. I'll stretch them out, but I actually have people follow me in the line. Okay, when I go down, and I probably prophesied over 150 people. It took me 2.5 hours. There was probably 3 people that heard every word that I said that weren't getting ministered to, just as a form of accountability. So I really, really want to encourage, does anybody have any questions about that, anything? Sticky notes are great. It just depends. I would really honestly encourage you, if you ever get a word for a leader, someone that has some type of authority either at your church or at a business, just write the word down. If you're looking for, you know, okay, I can write a word down for someone and they can have it and they can continue to look at it and they'll know exactly what I said versus just giving a 5-minute spontaneous word and they might remember 10% of it, I'm definitely going to go with the written down word. I write out a lot of prophetic words that I, especially those that aren't spontaneous. I've taught a lot on, there's really 2 types of prophecy. There's spontaneous prophecy, and then there's revelatory prophecy. The spontaneous prophecy is mostly what we do in here. We bring somebody to the center. We just encourage them on the fly, whatever God is saying. Your revelatory prophecy is going to have to do with direction. It's going to be a lot more weight behind what is being said. I always encourage you, write these down. Wait on these. This is my own personal experience. I've had so many bad experiences in the prophetic over the years because God was there and He was moving and no one wrote anything down. And months later, there was confusion. There was not remembering what is being said. And I really, really encourage you guys. I will not deliver a prophetic word to any leader in the body of Christ that's not written down and I don't have a copy of. Will not do it. Yes?
Do you think, I mean, obviously we're living in a different culture.
Sure.
Than when these words were penned in the inscription, when it was, the Holy Spirit was first being poured out. But do you find any of this in Scripture, I mean, is there any, there are safeguards in there like this, or did they do it differently? Is it because we're in a different culture and we have to be more careful?
Yeah. I think culture does have to play a part in it. And I think as far as these, guidelines for personal prophetic ministry, I mean, I would just say, probably coming from my own experience, this is something I know, ministry, is a very vulnerable place. They used to call it the revival babies. It's like when the Spirit of God starts moving, all these babies are born. And, there's so many intimate times in ministry when it's the Lord is tugging on your heart and wants to minister to you. And then you see people hanging on one another. I've been in groups before where I know guys that really have prophetic gifting that will pick out young girls and will tell them, the Lord says that you're beautiful and that, all this different stuff. And it's just one of these things that's like, man, you got to cut that out, So I don't know. I mean, I'm sure I could give you some scriptures and we could place them on the prophetic ministry, but there's probably no, prophetic guidelines for actually ministering. But I do think that the culture has to do with it. But I just, me personally, was just played on the safe side in that. So answered your question, but that's just mine.
So, talking about ministering over women, is your thinking that God will speak to them through someone else other than you? I mean, you said that you wouldn't deliver a word typically, but I mean, what is your thinking behind that as far as if God has spoken to you, if God wants to speak to someone?
Yeah, that's one of the things where I just think that even to me, with the whole sticky note thing or a carrying index cards, I would much rather, hand a single woman or whoever she might be an index card and say, hey, I'm Paul, this is what I felt the Lord said, take this with you, rather than engaging in a conversation, things like that. And it's the same thing. I mean, married women or married men, I'm always going to pull a spouse, and that's the best accountability. If I ever give a word to a spouse, I'm always going to pull in the other spouse as a form of, who better to hear the word, the spouse. I mean, they can encourage, they can, hey, you remember what they said, stuff like that. But, I'm not forbidding it. I'm saying this is me growing up. I've given a lot of prophetic words to a lot of different people, but once I've been married, for me personally, a lot of things have changed. I'm not saying, if you see, I think it might be a little bit different between, single people, but I'm just saying for me personally, I always try to play on the safe side and try to avoid ministry encounters that there could be anything goofy involved in it. Yes?
I might be wrong, but when I think about what I remember in Gospel, where personal prophecy has been talked about, it's always in the context of community. Yeah. Even personal prophecy, one, somebody giving a word to somebody else, but it's always in the context of a group, not individuals.
Yeah. I would agree with that. Graham Cook has a lot to say. He calls them, Graham talks about how he really wasn't, he calls them parking lot prophets. He wasn't really used to. He calls people in the West the people that kind of chase down people in parking lots. And all his training, he was never, ever, he calls that, he said there's a difference between personal prophecy and private prophecy. And he'll tell you he doesn't believe in private prophecy, which is tracking people down of the opposite sex or different people like that without either a recorder, a third-party witness, something like that. So he does make that distinction of, we can set somebody here and do personal prophetic ministry, but tracking somebody down out in the parking lot and saying this is what God is saying, and it can get so goofy, whether people are saying God told me to marry you or, give me, I heard of a guy that, a guy that was doing prophetic ministry that went into a church and kind of discerned this business guy and said that the Lord had said that the business guy was supposed to give the guy two-thirds of his business and that the Lord was going to bless him. So there's this prophetic guy that really had this agenda of, wanting, the $70,000 of his own money. And, it had caused this big uproar in this church because this church had this prophetic guy in and he had been accurate and they had developed relationship. So they brought Graham Cook into this situation, and Graham Cook went to this business guy first, and he's like, you know, do you feel manipulated and controlled? He's like, yes. He's like, well, you know, obviously this isn't what the Lord, you know, is desiring. You know, there needs to be more accountability. And he really accredits the accountability of the people around him helping this man to say, to discern that this isn't right. Because he really felt like if this guy had hunted this guy down and cornered him and said, he's going to say, okay, this guy is a prophet and he must hear from the Lord. So it was really the accountability of others. Because that's really the thing when we start receiving prophetic words, I always share it with the people that I love and say, what do you think about this? You know, what is it? They can really help to really guide it, you know. So any other questions? Yeah.
You said you don't lay hands on anybody you don't know. Like, what is the vulnerability?
Yeah. You know, I think it's good. I think that physical touch, you know, is something that is endearing. My love language is physical touch, so I naturally want to, but I kind of have to, especially if I don't know them. You know, I'll always say, do you mind if I lay my hand on your shoulder? You know, but there's a lot of times, you know, we're just trying to keep, you know, even on Friday night, when I was ministering to ladies, I would have someone someone lay hands next to them, and I'll lay hands, especially if my wife isn't present. You know, I'll just say, hey, you lay your hand, and I'll lay my hand on yours. And, you know, it's not like God's mad if you lay a hand on some people. I'm just giving my own personal, you know, Jeremiah's, you know. But, yeah, just asking them, you know, I've done that before where people were abused, you know, so physical touch totally turned them off to the, to the prophetic. Any other questions? I really want to, if anybody has any questions, please ask, because this is real important.
As far as that accountability, I was listening to Bob Jones yesterday. I think it's my first message I ever listened. But either way, long story short, he felt to pray for this woman who had cancer, and he felt to pray for her in a particular location. And he's like, no way, Lord. And the Lord kept on pressing him. So he brought all of his staff, 30 other people in, and said, listen, this is what the Lord said to do. And he talked to the woman and was like, yeah, I'm okay with that. But he brought in, it had to have been 30 to 60 people in there just to make sure that he was accountable, that there was no, you know.
Sure.
So.
Yeah, I think that's wise. Okay, corporate prophecy. And this whole corporate prophecy, this is really something that I really want to spend some time on tonight. I really feel like, in my opinion, there's a great disconnect in people's minds from learning about the prophetic to what it actually looks like in an actual church service. People might like, okay, it's okay if we like prophesy over people here, but if there's a church service, then we can't do it. So let me read here. I do not condone walking into random churches and prophesying from your seat. Prophetic people must come under proper authority in meetings. If you believe God has a word for the corporate body, always go to an elder or pastor and submit a word or the word to them first. There have been entire books that have been written from prophetic pastors to prophetic people that talk about the last two sentences. A lot of times, the most intimidating people for a pastor are prophetic people. And you really, really have to keep that in mind. Some of the most intimidating people for pastors are prophetic people. And I'm telling you, the prophetic gets a bad rap across denominational lines, because people have no relationship. They walk into churches, they stand up, they make scenes, they do all this crazy stuff, and they never, God has authority that he has set up in the church. And just because you believe you have a word from God doesn't give you the right to stand up and say whatever that you want. And I really, really am a firm believer in this. It's not about a free-for-all or disrupting a service. Okay, always go to an elder or pastor and submit the word to them first. If they do not think the word is for the service, then go sit down. Okay, I've seen before somebody walk up to a pastor, say this is a word from the Lord, and he said no, and they just said it anyways, and it caused a big scene. If they feel what the Lord has spoken to you is for that service, then wait patiently until an opportunity presents itself. Having a word from the Lord is never permission to disrupt a service. Save it for later. And this is just what I want to remind us. Relationship should be our first and greatest desire in the prophetic. It's all about relationship. If you do not like the way things are being done, build relationship and affect change. You can take that. That is my advice for business. That is my advice for relationship, for church. If you do not like the way something is being done, build relationship and affect change. A lot of people use prophetic words as a way to get back at something they don't like being done at the church. So, you know, the church is, you know, only an hour and 15 minutes, and a prophetic person thinks that they should let the Spirit flow for an hour and 15 minutes, and then they should preach. So he's mad. He's unwilling to even say anything to get to know the pastor or any of this. So he's going to stand up and prophesy that the Spirit's leaving the church because, you know, they're stiff-necked, okay? Build a relationship and affect change. This is something that's so important that so many are not willing to do, and I really, really want to stress this. Wherever church that you attend, really try to build a relationship. Let someone get to know your heart. A lot of shepherds, people that pastor, in a sense, you know, they have a job the Lord talks about to protect the flock, to guard against wolves in sheep's clothing. They have a God-given, you know, responsibility. And if they don't know you or you don't have relationship with them, they are going to receive any outburst or anything that doesn't smell or feel like humility. They are going to get on the offensive. I guarantee you that they will. I have actually been in places where I have never been to before, ever. And the Lord just spoke to me a really clear word, and I went up to the pastor and I said, hey, you know, my name's Jeremiah, and this is what I feel like they're saying. And they actually let me speak, you know. And it was just like, I really think that it was the act of humility. I wasn't threatening them. I wasn't telling them. I just said, hey, this is what I feel like God is saying. That's with you. I'll go sit down, and that's what I did. I said, I'll go sit down, and if you feel like, you know, you want me to come up, I'll go right back there. If not, totally fine. And moved on with that. So much of the fear that people have regarding the prophetic stems from the misuse or abuse of the gift of prophecy in corporate settings. We need to continue to seek relationship with those in authority rather than operating in a controlling manipulating spirit. So, real practically here at Heart of the Father Ministry, if anyone that comes to a service feels like God is speaking to someone, they have the opportunity to approach myself or Barry or my dad and say, hey, this is what I feel like God is saying. Would you mind if I shared it? Now, here's the catch. You have to be willing to submit to the word, and maybe we won't. So that's not for this service. Now, you can't get all offended and all, you know, this and that. A lot of people are afraid of being rejected. Maybe that's why they don't share. But I personally feel like there should be a lot more prophetic flow going on in our services that isn't happening. And I really want to encourage you all in this room that if you feel like God is saying something for the corporate body, please let me know, and let's begin to believe the Lord that He is going to speak. People have asked me, well, brother, or they've told me that would work in a small church, but that would never work in a big church. Okay, and this has always been my answer. Because we want relationship, okay, let's say, for example, I wouldn't let somebody, if someone that I never know, me personally, unless God spoke to me, someone that I never knew walked into one of our services and said, I have a word from God, okay, I'd first always say, okay, what is it? Okay, I'm not just saying, okay, here you go. I'll ask him, probably 99% of the time I'd say, hey, that's great, but let's build some relationship first. You know, there are people that will just stick around only if you let them prophesy, and when you don't, they'll be out on the next train, okay? But there has to be some type of that setup. So really what pastors need is they need some security. They need some relationship with some people. And if I personally was at a church, let's say I was at a church of 10,000 members, I believe in the prophetic ministry. I believe that the Holy Spirit can flow even at churches of 10,000. And if you have that grade of concern that someone is going to say something that's not biblical, that will scare people, I would simply have a handful of people that I would be training, or that I would like just have your staff up there. I mean, you know them. And that their specific job during the service, or one of the things that they could have the opportunity to do, was hear from God in the corporate setting and be given an opportunity to grab the mic and prophesy and let the Holy Spirit move through them. That would be, I would have a company of people at a large church that I trusted. I would be raising people up, allowing them to come to the group, allowing them to move in the Holy Spirit and the giftings. That's how I would try to maintain that. And obviously, if you had a mass amount of people that were willing to move in the prophetic, there's tons of different things, but a lot of people are like, the prophetic and the Holy Spirit are only for small churches. I don't believe in that at all. I believe that the Holy Spirit can speak through all men, all women. He can move it, but it's just, are we willing to let the Holy Spirit move? So we talked about personal prophecy, prophesying over someone. Now we're talking about corporately. So this is different. So I have some five questions here. If you believe you have received a corporate word, ask these questions. Is this a word God is speaking to me for the corporate body or for my own personal life? You're in a church service and you feel like God speaks to you. Is this God speaking to me, or is this for a corporate body? If you're dealing with, let's say, you know, lust, okay, you're in, and God is talking to you about purity, you have to ask yourself, okay, God, are you addressing purity issues in my heart, or do you have some word for the body that they need to be purified? Number two, do I sense that this word is for this service? Do I sense that this word is for this service? If this word, number three, if this word is for the corporate body, in what manner should I give this word? Really underline this parenthesis. Content needs to match delivery. You don't want to be prophesying about the kindness of God, screaming and being red in the face. I have seen this all the time. I'm like, oh, that was such a nice word, and you're yelling and screaming and you're scaring people. Now, there will be other times when the Lord speaks to you like a lion, and some passion and some enthusiasm and some vigor is needed. But those are all things that we need to consider. Four, is my filter clear? Do I have a judgmental heart or spirit against this body or leadership? We talked about that the first class. How's your filter? Are you clear in your thinking? Are you thinking correctly? And number five, does the word seem to confirm or join the flow of service? And this is really something that's constantly on my heart, is when we talk about corporate words, I'm not saying that God can't ever speak a word that has nothing to do with that particular service. But a lot of the times, if you have a corporate, if you have something to add to the body, an exhortation, something like that, I mean, I have, we've had meetings where the theme seemed to be about mercy. Okay, let's just say mercy. And God was speaking about mercy, and then someone will come up to me and say, you know, God gave me a word about something that was totally off the topic. Like, God was talking about, high or tithing or something like that. I mean, something totally off. It'd be like, okay, I'm not doubting that God spoke to you, but maybe that's for a different time. Maybe that's for a different service. Things like that. So, does the word seem to confirm or join the flow of service? Five questions. If you feel like God speaks to you for the corporate body, I would write those five things down, put them on a note card, laminate it, and put it in your pocket. And when you go to services, look at that and say, okay, this is something. This is really something that I have personally struggled with for a long time, is feeling like God gave me words for local bodies. On Friday, I delivered a corporate word for their service. And it was fun because they don't ever have corporate prophecy. And I got to give a corporate prophetic word for their body. And I invited everybody that it really touched to come up to receive ministry. And the word was about the Lord unveiling layers of healing specifically. So we invited people up, and then I just asked anybody in the crowd to come up and pray over the people. And it's awesome when body life takes place during a service. When people just don't have to stand there, they're never asked to pray for anyone, they're never asked to. So I just got this body activated, and now they're just getting hungry and hungrier to see the Lord. And now I've got some of these people going to the pastor and saying, hey, this is what I feel like God is saying, and she's allowing them to prophesy, and their body life is just, and going down there a couple times out, you can just see the flow of this thing starting to happen. So it is possible. Those are some questions that we can ask, questions about corporate prophecy. Say, like, conferences, never a good time to give a prophetic word. I've been to a couple prophetic conferences, and it's, been with people that thought that they had a prophetic word. I'm like, okay, man, well, there's like six major prophets over there, and I'm pretty sure, not that they don't care what you have to say, but let's defer to them and see what they think that the Lord is saying. And I know probably some of us haven't been around, but I have personally been in a circle before where people would just go up and grab the mic, and it's pretty embarrassing. Questions about, has anybody ever given a corporate word of prophecy, like from the front on the mic, something like that? Okay, two people. Okay. So let's really, it's just something that we can be asking. I think sometimes people are like, we come to services and it's like, to ask God what he's doing in the service. And I know from a ministry standpoint, I mean, you're like making sure that everything's in order, and let's sing a couple songs, let's do the message. But you never ask God, like, what are you speaking right now in this service? If we could freeze time, and you could take this collective people, whoever showed up, God, what do you want to do in the now, right here? What do you want to say? But see, what we've done a lot of times in the church is we order our services, okay? Like somebody says, oh, this is my service. And in case the Holy Spirit shows up, we'll leave room for him. There's a big difference between that and ordering your service as if the Holy Spirit is going to show up. There's a big difference between ordering a church service, and then if the Holy Spirit shows up, that's great, versus ordering your service in such a way that the Holy Spirit is going to show up. Practically, I would advise just having times of waiting on the Lord. I try to do that more often. Just worship team, let's just wait on the Lord. What is he saying? What does he want to speak? Because we have to get out of this Old Testament type of service that we're all just going to show up to a church service, listen to some guy tell us what God is saying, sit down and go home. Every single person in the body should be desiring to contribute something to a service, something. I've always really, really hammered this, that personal encounter, whatever's going on during the week, did you have a dream? Were you reading your Bible? Personal encounters should always lead to corporate change. Personal encounters should always lead to corporate change. And it doesn't say, like, whatever the pastor read should lead to corporate change. Sure, whatever the person is, I think that, you know, while I'm at it, I think that there is a, I think that there's some misunderstanding between, I'll just, for lack of words, the fivefold ministry, the pastors, prophets, apostles, teachers, pastors, evangelists. If turn in your Bibles to, let's go to 1 Corinthians 14. We just got to jump on this and see where the Lord takes us. See what the Lord just wants us to talk about. Because, guys, I really have a heart to get you guys activated. I'm not teaching this class just for my own sake. I really want that. If you said to me, you know, Jeremiah, why are you here? I would just simply say, I want to see each and every person that comes to this class not only learn about prophecy, but really be activated in it. Okay, 14:1. Pursue love, yet desire or lust, that says spiritual gifts, but especially that you may prophesy. For one who speaks in a tongue does not speak to men but to God, for no one understands him, but in his spirit he speaks mysteries. But one who prophesies speaks to men for edification, exhortation, and consolation or comfort. Go down and let's jump over to let's just keep reading. Go with me to verse 6. But now, brethren, if I come to you speaking in tongues, what shall I profit you, unless I speak to you either by a revelation or a knowledge or a prophecy of teaching? Yet even lifeless things, either flute or harp, in producing a sound, if they do not produce a distinction in the tones, how will it be known what is played on the flute or on the harp? For if the bugle produces an indistinct sound, who will prepare himself for battle? So it's beginning to talk about the gifts of the Holy Spirit. It's talking about prophecy specifically. I want to jump down, flip over to after verse 20. Let's read in 23. If therefore the whole church should assemble together and all speak in tongues and ungifted men or unbelievers enter, will they not say that you are mad? But if all prophesy and an unbeliever or an ungifted man enters, he is convicted by all that he is called to account by all. The secrets of his heart are disclosed, and so he will fall on his face and worship God, declaring that God is certainly among you. We had a young guy that came here probably 4 or 5 weeks ago, and Paul had met him at work, and he really claimed that he didn't know God or anything like that. And from my perspective, I was like, okay, this guy doesn't know you, and maybe a couple of songs and a message might touch his heart. But I really believe that God had a very specific word for him. So I preach a message, and I just started prophesying, calling out words of knowledge. And I called out a words of knowledge, and this guy just started weeping. He just started wailing. I mean, I think he even maybe gave his, did he have a conversion that day? or a rededication, I think something.
He rededicated, he hadn't been to church in 5 years.
Hadn't been to church in 5 years, but he had a personal encounter. Something of his heart was exposed. And to me, that's more like we were talking about last week. It's the power of the prophetic gift. What is God saying in that moment? It's not that the Word of God, the Logos Word of God, it's not that the Word of God is not capable. I don't want to portray that. It's not that we're not supposed to be preaching the Word, but we also have to understand that God can use us to prophetically, personally minister over someone in that group and really bring about a change in their life. So when we show up to, let's just say today's Monday, you've got Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday for God to do something in your life. Wow. I bet you He will do something. But see, that personal encounter is supposed to lead to a corporate change when? Or Thursday, or when we gather together. It doesn't have to be church services, but when maybe you take somebody out to eat, or maybe something that happened during that week, it's an active testimony. This is what God is doing in my life. Let me share that with you. We understand that. The spirit of prophecy is the testimony of Jesus. When we testify, we prophesy. I've talked about this on Sunday, but this is just something that the Lord... Go to Revelation 19:10.
Worship him, but he said to me, "Do not do that. I am a fellow servant of yours and your brethren who hold the testimony of Jesus. Worship God, for the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy."
So the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. I have translated this: who you say Jesus is will directly affect the way that you prophesy. Who you say that Jesus is will directly affect the way that you prophesy. The testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. When I listen to people prophesy, I say to myself, they're telling me their revelation of Christ. But let's take a little different look at it. The spirit of prophecy is the testimony of Jesus. Let's say that we had a miracle at the church. Let's say someone had a knee that was blown out and they couldn't walk. They came to church with crutches on. And we all laid hands on them and believed for a miracle, and they were totally healed and set free. Is that a testimony of Jesus, that healing?
Jesus healed.
Okay, He healed. It's a testimony of Jesus. So what does then that become? That's a prophecy. It's what God is saying is, this is what I want to do. I've said this before. I believe here at the church, as much weight as we'll put on testimonies, that's how many miracles we will see in this body. I have seen it all the time where someone was radically healed. And I've back problems, and somebody testified at another service. And don't you know that over 5 people with back problems were instantly healed because that person that was healed testified, prophesied to those people, "This is for you too," and they were instantly healed. See, but we've lost the power of testimony in the church. You hardly ever go anywhere where they make time for people to testify about what God is actively doing. What addiction are they being set free from? Did they have any physical healing? Have they received emotional healing? This is something that's really powerful, because when you begin to think about all that God is doing in your life, Many of us are like, well, I don't have a prophecy. Well, maybe your personal testimony of what God has delivered you and set you free from is a prophecy that will set and deliver someone else free. So this is it's a prophetic take on Revelation 19:10. The spirit of prophecy is the testimony of Jesus. There's so much power in testimony. I'm telling you, if we would just testify, if we would hear from everybody, if we would allow them to, hey, this is my personal encounter. Again, we kind of got to feel out the service. What's the Lord saying? You know, I mean, a lot of times I just stand there and I look at the lyrics of the songs. And I'm like, what message are they communicating? What is God trying to do here? But again, if we just show up and four songs and a message and I'm out of here, you're like, okay. Maybe we missed what God... That's the cry of the prophetic is this, what is God saying now? What is God saying now? It's not we're just going to pray a little prayer over our buddy. It's what would God speak to my friend in this moment now? When I pray over people, I'm like, I know a decent amount of scripture. I've memorized it. It's not just, you know, quoting them anything from James or 1 Peter or Genesis. It might come to mind and maybe it's the Lord, but I'm really asking, Lord, is there a specific scripture that I know that's really applicable to what I'm sensing is going on in their life right now? A lot of time, it's funny, people just take scriptures as prophecy. Scripture is prophecy, it's true. But I don't know if you've ever walked up to somebody and just had this scripture pop to mind, and you're like, that's probably because God is revealing himself to them now. He's speaking in that moment through his word. And again, it's not like the prophetic versus scripture and we're after each other. It's the word of God is our foundation and the prophetic adds on to the word. If the prophetic contradicts the scripture, we're throwing it out. So each and every person, if you attend church here, I really want to challenge you to always come to service really asking the Lord, Lord, do you have a corporate word? Lord, is there anybody in this church service tonight that I could give a word to, that I could share your heart with? So I'm saying we don't, because it's about, we read in 1 Corinthians 14, it's about showing up and having a desire to exhort and encourage and comfort one another. We have to do our part as the body of Christ. We have to do our part. Not just sitting there and letting some minister tell us what God is saying. Sure, he might tell you what God is saying, but you yourself can tell somebody else what God is saying as well. Because it's really not about prophets or prophecy. It's about a company of prophetic people that can all hear the Lord themselves. The primary job of a prophet is not to prophesy. It's to teach people how to prophesy. Primary job of a prophet is not to prophesy, it's to teach people how to prophesy. We should really, I mean, you know, and to me, it doesn't matter if there's one or two people here. I just know that if we'll devote our lives to hearing the Lord, to me there's nothing really better that you can do. I really don't know, because every day, I don't know about you, but every day I need to hear God. Every day. Every day we make decisions. Something comes up, and it's imperative. If you can't feel God, you'll walk around without vision. You'll be confused. You'll be dazed. And it's like, how many people do you know? They're lost, but they're not willing to spend time with the Lord. Let me just finish up, and we'll do questions. Rhema, Matthew 4:4. So Rhema, R-H-E-M-A. There's the Rhema Bible Institute. Barry went to it. You can ask him about it. The word Rhema means an utterance. It's in Scripture, it has to do with a now word, a Rhema word. I don't know if you ever heard somebody say, we need a Rhema word from God. What is he saying now? Okay. The Rhema word in biblical terms refers to a portion of Scripture that speaks to a believer. Again, how many people did it some type of devotional today? Anybody just read? Was there anything that like maybe stuck out to you more than another? I was like reading Proverbs 19 this morning. And verse 4 It was, and this is how it works for me. I was reading verse 4, and somebody immediately came to mind. And I was like, okay, it must be for them. Just texting them, and the Lord just gave me a little word out of that. Sometimes you just, even in your devotional, something will pop out at you and say, okay, this is applicable for right now. This makes sense. And I really want to encourage you, just read your Bible tomorrow, and if anything comes to mind, just... Guys, you can't really be wrong prophesying a scripture to someone. I mean, it's God's word. It's encouraging. You know, just think about it tomorrow. Okay, Lord, you know, maybe you've got a little... Some of the most encouraging times of my life have just been in the scriptures. Someone that gave me a scripture that was real applicable for my situation. In most cases, a rhema word received while reading the Bible applies to a current situation or need. In essence, the rhema word is timely and extremely valuable. That Matthew 4:4, that's man does not live on bread alone, but from every word that comes from the mouth of God. Man does not live on bread alone, but every word, that word is rhema. Man does not live on bread alone, but from every rhema word that comes out of the mouth of God. This is really my heart's cry, is we really need to be walking around having the rhema word of God. That's the difference between eagles and vultures. Eagles only eat fresh catch. A lot of the older prophetic groups, they have something to do with eagles. Fresh catch. Eagles will never eat anything that's dead or that's stale. Vultures, what do? If it's dead, I'm eating it. If it's alive, I'm not going after it. We can't be vultures in our spiritual walk. We can't just be looking for the dry and the stale and the regurgitated. We have to say, Lord, I need a fresh word from you. Something in the ministry that's so important. It really takes time to hear from the Lord. It's so easy these days just to read books and just preach it. Just to, you know, read some commentary and proof text it and preach it on Sunday. It's easy, but really getting on our knees and our faces, just saying, God, you know, what does this body need, or what do you want to speak right now, and really, you know, speak to me. I really think that we really are in great need of that in today's in America. So, do we have any questions about any of that? Promise me that when you start coming to services, you're at least going to ask the Lord if he's got anything to say.